Hi everyone, welcome to Teachers in the Parks. Today, we're going to be doing some exciting things relating to inferences. But first, I have some fun brain teasers for you as a warm-up. So we'll take a look over here at the left side of the screen. We're going to take a look at the pictures, and you can decide which one would be mountains, one, two, or three. Which square would be a picture of plains? And which do you think would be rolling hills? So you can make your choice, one, two, or three. Which are mountains, plains, and hills? When you've made your choice, we're going to take a look right underneath that rectangle at the would you rather. Take a minute to think. Would you rather run a mile or walk a mile? Would you rather run a mile or walk a mile? Running might make you tired. Walking, you might be able to enjoy a more scenic route, but running might get you somewhere faster than walking. But what would you rather do? Run a mile or walk a mile? It's all in your own preference. Once you've thought about that, if you're at home with a sibling or a parent or guardian, maybe you could share your would you rather with them. Or you could write it down, or even just think about it to yourself. We'll move over to the middle of our screen, where we're going to be given clues, and we have to determine which fruit our clues are telling us this may be. So, which fruit is red and covered in tiny seeds? One of my favorites in the summertime. If you're thinking strawberry, you are probably correct. Which fruit starts out green, turns yellow, then becomes brown? Monkeys love to eat this fruit. If you've guessed banana, you are correct. Number three, which fruit grows on a vine in bunches? They can be red, green. If you guessed grapes, you are correct. And another one of my favorite fruits. This fruit is fuzzy on the outside and like a brownish tannish color and green on the inside. This one is a little tricky. But if you guessed kiwi, you are correct. Kiwi. Down below, you can find the pattern. We have 120. We are going down, decreasing in our numbers to 100. Getting smaller with 80. Smaller with 60. What would our next number be? If you said 40, you are correct. We are decreasing by 20 each time. So then our next number in our set would be 20, because 40 minus 20 gives us 20. Our next thing to think about in our little warm-up here is a sunflower living or not? So we have to think about, what do we need if we are living things? We usually need sunlight, food, water. So if you said yes, a sunflower is living, you are correct. Number two, a fossil. Is a fossil living or not? If you said no, you are correct. Number three, soil. Soil helps living things grow, but is soil itself living? Ooh, if you said no, you are correct. Over here, number four, apple tree. Is an apple tree living or not? An apple tree grows and it needs water and sunlight. So if you said yes, it is living, you are correct. Number five, a narwhal. Very strange and interesting creature, but it is in fact living. And number five, a rock. If you said no, that is not living, you are correct. Let's make our way up top here. Raptor or not? Think about a raptor. What would be a characteristic of a raptor? Do you think a sparrow would be considered a raptor? When I think of a raptor, I think of sharp talons, sharp claws. So do you think a sparrow would be a raptor? And a raptor is also considered a bird of prey. They primarily hunt and feed on vertebrae that are large and relative to the hunter. So if you said no, you are correct. What about an eagle? If you said yes, you are correct. A mockingbird? No, a mockingbird's not a raptor. And what about an owl? An owl is, yes, most definitely. Okay, moving on really quickly. Which two do not belong? So as I'm looking through one through five here, I can see that these all remind me of types, well, not all of them, two of them do not belong, but most of them look like types of dances. Two of them are types of music. So we're going to go through and see which two are the types of music and not necessarily dances. So which two don't belong? We have the tango, the cha-cha, the samba, rock and roll, and rap. So which two are just types of music or genres of music and not necessarily dances? Which two do not belong? The tango, cha-cha, the samba, rock and roll, and rap. Okay, if you said rock and roll for one, you are correct. It's a type of music, okay? Pretty cool to listen to, but not necessarily a dance. And if you said rap, then you are also correct. So these top three are types of dances. And these two are just types of music that you can listen to. All right, and the last 30 seconds, I just want you to talk to somebody at home and tell them as many birds that come to mind, list them. So talk to somebody at home, or if you have a whiteboard or paper in front of you, list as many birds as you can. How many birds can you name? Types of birds. In the next 30 seconds, go. All right. Hopefully you were able to come up with a lot of birds. If not, that's okay. I know that I can really only think of maybe a handful, 7 or 8. So awesome job, guys. Hopefully you enjoyed that little warm up of brain teasers. Okay, let's move on to our actual lesson for today. One of my favorite things to teach and learn about would be inferences. So today, our I can statement, or what we're going to be able to do after our lesson, is read for clues and think about what I know to make an inference. So we're going to be looking at pictures today, using our background knowledge, and reading some text to make inferences or infer what we think might be happening in the text or in the picture. Sometimes a text may not have a picture, so we have to use what we know and what we're looking for in the text, some clues, some background knowledge to help us make an educated guess as to what we think is actually happening in the story. So what is an inference? An inference is just a big fancy schmancy word for saying it's the process of making an educated guess about a text based on the clues it provides and our understanding of the world. So your experiences, your background knowledge, what you know, and just making a guess based on that. And clues that you see in the picture or clues that you can pick out from the text. So putting all of those things together to just make an educated guess. That is what an inference means. Okay, one of my favorite pictures here. We're going to take a minute. I want you to think about what you can infer by looking at this picture. So some questions you may ask is, where might she be? How might she be feeling? Is she scared? Is she happy? Is she excited? You can look at her facial cues, her facial expression here. What might she be doing? Is she on a ride? Is she in a new environment that might be scaring her? Is she at a haunted house? What is her setting? What is her environment? What might she be doing to make her be feeling this way? Okay, so you may write it down. You can share with somebody at home. What can you infer she is doing based on what you can see is happening in this picture? So I will give you a minute to think. Please share out with someone at home. If no one is nearby, you can certainly write this down on a whiteboard, or if you have paper in front of you, you can certainly use that as well. So I myself, looking at this, might infer that she looks scared. I can look and see her facial expression. Her eyes are big. This is a face I would make if I was afraid of something. If I'm on a ride, like a roller coaster, and I'm scared, I would definitely be making this face. Now, I have been to Knoebels and I have seen rides like this. I think it's a long slide and you get on like a big potato sack and you go down the slide super fast. So, from what I know from my background knowledge and what I have seen, this looks like the exact same sort of ride that I have seen that I believe she is on. This looks like some sort of big sack or rug. And it looks like she's going down a slide and she is going super fast and she's probably pretty scared. So that is what I can infer. If you inferred something different, that is okay. So that was an inference looking at a picture. We can also make an inference by reading a text or a piece of text. So based on this text, I can use my background knowledge and make an inference. Dylan walked into the room. Everyone is either quietly reading a book or finding a good book to read. Some children are at the desk checking out books to take home. So I know that from my experience, I can pick out keywords such as quiet. I know that it's quiet when I visit a library, and I know that there are usually people either reading or finding good books to read. And when they're done, they take a book or two and usually check them out. So I can infer that Dylan is in the library. So, no, whoops. Let's go back. There we go. So nowhere in this text did it say Dylan walked into the library. But based on keywords that I can pull out and my own background knowledge, because I have been into many libraries, I can use my own experiences to make an inference and infer that Dylan is in a library. Okay, so we have a few picture clues here. I want you to take a minute, and based on these picture clues, what can we infer? We have a sleeping bag, some fish on a hook, a backpack, a tree, we're probably somewhere in the woods or the wilderness, a flashlight that we would use in case it gets dark, and some marshmallows that I might roast on a campfire. So think about these pictures, how they might all relate somehow, and what can I infer? What activity might I be doing? Where might I be? What could I infer that I am doing? Okay. I know that I can infer that I am probably going on a hike and going camping. I've been camping many times. I know that I need a sleeping bag. A flashlight is good for when it gets dark at night, we can see. I know that I make a campfire and I love to make s'mores, so I need to roast some marshmallows. When we go hiking and I take my dogs, I always have a backpack filled with their water and a water bowl. I don't go fishing when I go camping, but I know that there are fish in the rivers and ponds and lakes. But some people do like to take out a boat or just go along the side of the streams and rivers and go fishing. So that's something fun to do. That's a fun activity. And a lot of people, when they go camping, hiking, it's in the woods, so there are a lot of trees. So based on these picture clues and my background knowledge, I can infer that these pictures relate to going camping. Okay, I'm now going to use some text to make an inference. Frank dragged himself down the street. He couldn't wait to get all the way home. It had been the worst day of his life. As he walked, the people walking in the other direction gave him funny looks. He considered this and realized he must look pretty strange. His face was covered in soot. So soot is like black ash. If you have a fireplace and it gets kind of smoky, the black ash from the fire would be considered soot. And his clothes were singed. Ooh, almost like he was near a fire, with little holes burned and tattered around the edges. He'd even lost one of his shoes. Okay, so based on this first paragraph, what clues can you gather about Frank? So I can gather that even though I can't see a picture of Frank, this was very vivid and detailed. And I know that people are looking at him funny, probably because he has soot and ash all over him. His clothes look like he was burned. He has little holes in them. So, and he lost a shoe. So I'm wondering if something terrible happened to him that he looks that way. It had started out like an ordinary day. If only he'd taken his normal route to work. Why did he have to walk by the toothpick factory today of all days? That was the last time he'd ever go down Burnham Street. He wouldn't take that risk ever again. Okay, so what clues can you gather about Frank's day? Obviously, he is not having a really good day. And normally, he has a good day, an ordinary day, but he clearly did not take his normal route to work, so something must have happened on his detour. Let's continue to read to find out. As he walked past the Shanahan's house, he could hear the TV blasting with the nightly news. Well, Ted, it was all thanks to one local man. The flames were barely starting to creep through the windows when he arrived like Superman. Unfortunately, he didn't stay long enough to give his name. All we have is an item of clothing he left behind, probably as he climbed out the window after saving the building from ruin. Back to you at the studio, Ted. The Shanahans began discussing the program. Wow, did you hear that? Right here in our own neighborhood. Okay, so after reading that, what clues can you gather about the event that happened this day? The clues that I can gather would be that our character probably saved someone from a burning building or helped put out a fire. And that's probably why he looks that way. Okay. Frank rolled his eyes and realized he'd never called his boss at work to explain why he didn't come in this morning. He hoped his boss would forgive him once he found out what a day he'd had. Climbing the steps in front of his house, he warily turned the doorknob and opened the door. He called to his wife, "Sarah, you'll never believe what happened to me today." Okay, so based on all of this information, okay, we're introduced to Frank. He's looking pretty rough. Okay, he took a detour to work. All right, he hears on the news that some man left one item of clothing after he went into a burning building. What do we think happened to Frank? I'll give you a minute to think. Do we think Frank was the man that the news anchors were talking about? Okay, the text isn't telling us directly, but based on what we know and the clues that the passage has given us, we can make an inference. Okay, so on your own, in the next minute or so, there's an inference card that I will read you what it says. Our purpose question is, what activity is Maxwell participating in? All right, so Maxwell was bored standing in the same position for such a long time. Nothing had come his way. He was just waiting for three outs, waiting for the time when he could get his free snow cone. Suddenly, he saw it hurtling through the sky toward him. He raised his left hand and plop! He caught it. The crowd cheered, woo! As he raced all the way to the dugout. Okay. So, to make an inference, we can underline clues. We can think about what we know and figure out what makes sense. Okay, so based on this passage, we can tell what? Where's Maxwell? What activity is Maxwell participating in? So I will give you a minute. You can write it down. You can share with someone at home. What activity is Maxwell participating in based on what we've read here? Okay, so I would say the three outs, free snow cone, something's hurtling through the sky towards him, he caught a ball, the crowd's cheering, and he's racing all the way to the dugout. So he must be participating in a baseball game. Okay, we have another inference card. Our purpose question here is, what kind of animal is Betty? So we're going to be given clues. Remember, to make an inference, if you were to have this in front of you, you'd be able to underline the clues. But think about what you know and figure out what makes sense. The grass was green beneath Betty's hooves. Ooh, keyword hooves. As she sauntered over to the fence. She switched her tail from side to side to swat away flies that were always surrounding her. So I know that she's out on the land. She is within a fence. She has a tail. She's swatting away flies. Maybe it was all the manure that they were attracted to. Betty leaned forward and chomped on some grass, slowly chewing it as she made her way back to the barn for milking time. This one might be a little bit easier. She needs to go back to the barn to get milked. So what animal could she be? All right, we know that cows get milked. So if you said cow, you are correct. Okay, the last thing that we have today is just a little writing piece that you can do on your own. You're going to look at this picture and tell me in writing what you can infer is happening. How do you know? So think about the setting. Where is this character? What is she doing? How do you think the dog is feeling? Okay, where could she be going? What's going to happen to her? All of these things you can infer based on looking at this picture and based on your background knowledge. Okay, so you can take the next few minutes on your own. Make sure that you start your sentence or your paragraph, however much you want to write, with I can infer whatever is happening in the picture. So take a few minutes. This is what we're going to end with today, a little writing activity. All right, everyone. Thank you for joining me today. That was day one of inferences. I hope that you learned a little bit and you had some fun. I will see you tomorrow. Have a great day.